συνέχεια θα έχουμε τον πρώτο διακεκριμένο μιλητή, τον κύριο Αθανάσιο Μελιόπουλο, ο οποίος έρχεται από το Πανεπιστήμιο Georgia Tech και η ομιλία του θα είναι Great Transformation, Challenges and Opportunities. Ο κύριος Μελιόπουλος είναι διακεκριμένος καθηγητής στο Georgia Tech, έχει πατέντες, 3 βιβλία, πάνω από 270 εργασίες, είναι εξαιρετικά δημοφιλή τα έργα του στην περιοχή και νομίζω ότι θα δώσει ένα ιδιαίτερο τόνο με την ενδιαφέρουσα ομιλία του.
Καλημέρα σας. Θα ήθελα να ευχαριστήσω την Οργανωτική Επιτροπή για την πρόσκληση που μου έκανε και είμαι πάρα πολύ χαρούμενος να βρίσκομαι στην όμορφη Θεσσαλονίκη. Έχω γεννηθεί και μεγάλωσα στην Κατερίνη και η Θεσσαλονίκη είναι πάντοτε στην καρδιά μου. Όταν ήμουν στο γυμνάσιο θυμάμαι ακόμη ότι ερχόμουν στην Διεθνή Έκθεση να πιω μαύρη μπύρα. Πιστεύω να έχουμε ακόμη μαύρη μπύρα στη Διεθνή Έκθεση, ας πούμε. Και θα ήθελα να ευχαριστήσω τον κύριο Κοσμήτορα, τον πρόεδρο, για την υποστήριξη αυτής της εκδηλώσεως και τον κύριο Χατζηλεοντιάδη για την επίβλεψη όλης αυτής της οργάνωσης. Και είμαι πολύ συγκινημένος ότι 17 φοιτητές η Οργανωτική Επιτροπή με πολλούς εθελοντάς έβαλαν τέτοιο μεγάλο πρόγραμμα και σαν Έλληνας του εξωτερικού, βλέποντας και παρακολουθώντας τι γίνεται στην Ελλάδα οικονομικά και πολιτικά στα τελευταία χρόνια, αισθάνομαι πάρα πολύ αισιόδοξος για το μέλλον, βλέποντας σας και την οργάνωσή σας εδώ. Η Ελλάδα πάντοτε θα προοδεύει με το πολύ δυναμικό που έχουμε εδώ πέρα. Λοιπόν, η παρουσίαση μου σήμερα θα είναι σχετικά με αυτό που αναφερόμαστε σαν smart grid. Δυστυχώς θα την κάνω την παρουσίαση στα αγγλικά, διότι θα έχω αρκετά μεγάλο πρόβλημα να μεταφράζω συνέχεια, ας πούμε. Έχω πάνω από 42 χρόνια εκτός της Ελλάδος, οπότε θα μου επιτρέψετε να κάνω την παρουσίαση στα αγγλικά. So I will talk to you today about grid transformation and the challenges and opportunities. And I would like to conclude basically with a call to you to get involved in this area. It is a very fertile research area. First of all, let's do some observations. The energy, and especially the electric energy, is the fuel of modern economy. If we look what happened in the United States in 2003, where we had a massive blackout and about 50 million people left without electric power, everything came to standstill. Banks, organizations, and so everything stopped for one full day. And of course, that was a very heavy economic cost. Increased energy prices have elevated the energy issues to the forefront of our concerns. We have environmental concerns, talk about global warming, pollution and so on, pushes more and more for renewable energy resources and all the problems associated with the renewable energy resources. And of course, anytime there is a blackout, loss of electric energy, makes news and a very big economic impact in the society. So the idea of the smart grid, which has become the buzzword in the recent years, is basically to integrate all the energy resources into an efficient, reliable, and economical system. And of course, we are very far away from achieving the goals of the smart grid. Now, I would like you to take a look at the big picture. Since the early days, electricity started infiltrating all parts of economic life. In other words, everything that we used to be done 150 years ago by other means has been electrified. And today, we use, from the total energy consumption, we use about 40% in the form of electric energy. So this graph here shows basically all the energy sources, petroleum, gas, nuclear, and so on. And the other end, it shows in what form this energy finally used. Notice that about 40% constitutes the electric power system. And if we look at the picture of how this structure evolved over the years, we can see here that initially it was zero electric energy back 130 years or so, and today we're 40%, the transportation is another 30%, and the rest of the energy uses is another 30%. Now, of course, what is happening, we see today that the transportation is being electrified. We have electric cars, pluggable electric cars, and so on. This means that there is a potential that all this 30% here will become electric, in which case going to make the electric power system 70% of the total energy consumed. Okay? So on the other hand, not only transportation, but other commercial and industrial processes are being electrified. So eventually, it's not unrealistic to think that everything, any energy consumed is going to be in the form of electric energy, or a very big percentage. So what drives everything that we see today? Basically, environmental concerns is at the forefront, and we see the impact of this, and also all the other issues that were related. You obviously heard about some countries like Germany, they will phase out nuclear power, and so on. All of this generates a lot of new challenges in the system. Increased number of customers own active electric systems, roofs with photovoltaic arrays, wind, and so on. And that generates another portfolio of available energy resources from the customers. We see operational uncertainty because the more of these renewables come into the system, the more we are vulnerable to the way that wind generates and wind blows and so on. And remember, the Greeks know about this. The ancient Greeks, when they set sail for Troy, they had a problem with the wind. Okay? So that generates uncertainty. We have also operational complexity. The more of the systems we have, the more complex the system becomes, and we have to deal with this complexity. And also, we have also protection issues, because now we have electrical systems that go all the way down to the customer, and we have more possibility of safety issues and so on. And let's face it, something that we do not discuss is that every year we have a very large number of electric fatalities, people that are electrocuted because of something went wrong to the system. So there are many promising technologies that we continuously explore. And you see every day new devices based on these various sources. Wind energy, we see that at very large scales. Similarly, for photovoltaics, we see things at large scale as well. Electric and pluggable electric vehicles, geothermal, fuel cells, smart appliances, and many, many more. The smart appliances is nothing else than the usual appliances. We have dryers, heaters, and so on. But now what we do, we place a computer on them so we can control them at our will. So that generates a lot of additional options. So a typical, thank you. So a house may look something different from what it used to look in the past. So basically, every appliance has a microprocessor that can be controlled, turn on and turn off, and also the actual system experiences some transportation, a transformation. You can see a lot of wind, you see a lot of fuel cells, solar cells, and so on, that are distributed throughout the system. People talk about organize them in micro grids and so on. And the bottom line is that there are all these new resources that they provide challenges in the way of operating the system, but also opportunities for optimizing and increasing the efficiency of the system. Now, the challenges have to do with the fact that a lot of these new technologies is what we call inertialess. That is, they're all interfaced with power electronics, which can change their status very fast from in sub-cycle period and so on. And that generates different challenges because everything we have in controlling the system and so on is based on the fact that we have electromechanical machines and so on that have certain inertia. So that generates a new paradigm of controlling the system. The protection control of the system is also something that we cannot solve with traditional protection and control methodologies. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about protection later on. And also how we manage to balance the loaded generation. As you know, for electricity, we have the basic constraint that we need to produce the amount of electricity at the time that is needed. So we store very little of it because the storage of electric energy is relatively expensive compared to other technologies, so there is very little storage in the system. Yep. And of course we have economic viability because energy is so fundamental to the economic operation of a nation, and therefore we need to make sure that we provide electric energy at the minimum possible cost. Now, certain technologies is what we call a win-win situation. Here is an example, a summary of a project where we look at the following issue. What will happen if we start electrifying the transportation sector? More and more electric cars, more and more pluggable electric cars. You can see here that, of course, this kind of simulations require a full simulation of the electric power system with all the uncertainties and so on. The end result is that as we increase the percentage of the electric cars into the system, the prices will go moderately up, 3%, 6% for 10 penetration to 20 penetration. And this particular study was done for a typical power system with the traditional mix of generation, nuclear, coal, gas, and so on. The loss of load probability goes moderately up. However, the pollution is reduced as we increase more and more of the pluggable electric cars. So this is an example where basically a small moderate increase in prices can provide a lot of reduction in the environmental impact of the electric power system. Now, on the other hand, things are not always the same with other technologies. I would like to explain this graph a little bit because we have a lot of utilities today that have a substantial amount of wind power and photovoltaic power. Okay? And what happens in these cases is the following. Initially, of course, we have the total load of the system is shown here. And then we have the wind, and here is a typical production of the wind for that particular area. This is in the state of California. And also there is some substantial PV, and this is the production of PV. So the rest of the thermal units, they're gonna see a net load, which is given by this expression here. Notice what is happening here that generates a lot of operational problems. First of all, during the morning hours, while we had a gradual increase of the load, now we have a steeper increase of the apparent load that exists in the system. That generates an issue of the generating units following that load. Okay? So we have issues with ramp rates and so on. On the other hand, we have the following issue that the wind can go off at any time, similarly with the PV, and therefore we need a lot more higher reserve requirements if something happens to be able to continue the operation and supply electric power to the customers. Okay. And then we have the other issue as the renewables change very frequently depending on the events of the day. Then the thermal units have to follow the net load and they start cycling, and that generates another operational issue. And the other very important issue is that we have abrupt changes in the system, and we have to have what we call a frequency response. That is, if we lose a large unit, then the frequency of the system should change a little bit only, so we can give us time to take care of the balance between load and generation and so on. With the new systems, we see that we do not have this capability. That is, anything happens to the system, we have a very abrupt change in frequency and a lot of additional problems that we have to deal with. Yeah. So the question is how we deal with that. As an example, I'm going to give you an idea of a product we developed with Georgia Tech with General Electric. And this is referred to as the reservometer. The idea of this product is the following. If we have a two-way communication between the end user and the utility, then we can monitor the operation of the house through what we call a home area network, which is nothing else, just a very simple system that monitors all the appliances, the cars and so on in the system. The air conditioners and so on, and then asks the following question. Without inconvenience the customer, without inconvenience the homeowner, how much we can cut off in electric demand, or we can produce in case we have an electric car or a PV roof and so on, provide back to the utility. That has to be done in real time, continuously. And you get a picture that is shown here. Of course, the picture, I'm sorry, that is not very visible. But basically, we have the capability to provide some relief from, let's say, from the air conditioner along, which operates as follows. Basically, the temperature goes up and down between the sets of the thermostat, the settings of the thermostat. But what we can realize is the following. If the utility is needing some relief, let's say at this time, when the temperature at this point and the air conditioner is working, then we can cut off the air conditioner for a certain amount of time until the temperature starts increasing again back to the settings, and then we have to restart the air conditioner. So if we sum all of this from all the appliances and so on, if we have a smart appliances and so on, we can have an indication of how much this particular house can provide to the utility. That may be a very small quantity, let's say half kilowatt for 5 minutes. But if you aggregate all of this from all the customers and so on, then that's enough for the utility to take care of the problems that arise during operations, if lost a unit and so on. And therefore, we don't have to have expensive reserves in the power system. So that's the idea, what can be done with this kind of technology. So, then the other question is the following. What will happen if all the generation comes from renewables? We're not at this point yet, but we have a lot of utilities that they have renewables that are more than 50% of their installed capacity. For example, if we look at 50 hertz in Germany, their installed capacity in renewables is 54%, and 46% is conventional generation. So we move it towards this direction. We working with not only with the United States utilities, but also with the European utilities to address this problem and ask the question, what will happen if all the renewables are renewables. What's all the generation is renewables. What happens in this case is that all the generation is interfaced to the system through power electronics, that they do not have inertia, and then we have to have a totally new way of controlling and operating the system. Okay? There are, the system is more dynamic, it has more problems, but also has more opportunities to operate the system in a better way. So we have technical issues, reliability issues, and economic issues that we need to address in this case. So we need comprehensive solutions to, to this problem. And comprehensive solutions can become through a lot of hard work. Beware of simple answers. Okay? You know that Thrasymachus was a sophistis in the era of Socrates. So the obvious solutions are not always feasible. Okay. Now, let's take a lesson from another industry. We know now everybody has an iPhone or a similar contraption. So what the iPhone has done is has integrated a lot of facilities, a lot of tools into one single device. Okay. And you're familiar with that. And as a matter of fact, the best is yet to come because people working on making the cell phone to project the screen, to project a keyboard, so you can use it as a personal computer with a full keyboard, full screen, and so on. So the best is yet to come from this integration. So why we don't do the same thing with the electric power industry? Here is the idea that we've been working at Georgia Tech with a lot of utilities and a lot of organizations, is to integrate the whole operation of the entire system from the customer all the way to the control center, okay? Including the residential customers and including big plants and so on. The idea is very simple. Basically, we need to, basically today, the entire operation of the electric power grid is through computers, a very vast system of distributed computers, whether they're in the form of numerical relays or smart meters or sophisticated controllers of a plant and so on. All of this is computers talking to each other and operating the system. Okay. So the question is this, why we don't make all of these computers work the to talk the same language, either talk to each other and automatically operate the system, starting from the end users, where the whole distribution system can be done autonomously monitoring and controlled, then going to the substations, and then going to the control center and the plants and so on, and generating all of this. Now, notice that what we need to do is generate technology that will manage the system autonomously, fully automated substation protection and control, and fully automated energy management system. This system exchanges information, monitors and knows what's going on in the system in real time, optimizes the system, and if anything happens to the system, controls, responds to these events to control the system properly. Now, the requirements for autonomy are multiple. I'm going to sum some of them. The first of, thing we need to do is to be able to do autonomously the extraction of the model of the system in real time, because everything we do in the power system is based on model control, model-based control. Then we need to have a system that autonomously, continuously extracts the model of the system. And this can be done with what we call setless protection that I'm gonna talk about in a second. And then once we have the model, then we can start doing self-regulating and self-managing of the system. Self-regulating has to do with the fact that we try to operate the system on an instant basis, and self-managing is by taking into account all the resources in the system, and we try to plan the operation of the system in such a way that we optimize the economics of the system. Okay? Both of these problems are needed. So, for example, an autonomous state estimation will work as follows. Here is a simple example where if I have, let's say, a commercial outfit, an industrial outfit, or a house and so on, all I have to do is make the devices that they control in the system smart And the basic idea is to the devices that we're using for monitor, and so on, all we have to do is give it a little bit more intelligence to know what is the device model, what is the device measurements, that's typically what the meters are doing, what is the connectivity, is it connected to what point in the system, and what are the controls of the device. Basically, we can take all of this information, pack it into the smart meters and so on, and then have this information transmitted to other parts of the system where we can extract the model not only of a device or one factory, but the model of the entire system, and then we use this to do integrated optimization, control, and operation of the system. So it's a very basic idea, and the basic principle is to make the devices smarter to transmit this information. So we need to build some basic building blocks that will do this function. And the basic building blocks depend on these few principles. First of all, we digitize, we separate the data acquisition system with the of these devices. Then we objectify. Objectify means that we take all this information, measurements, model, connectivity, controls, and so on, and we put them in a form that is recognizable by computers. So it's sort of teaching the computers the same language. Think about the fact that, let's say, if we have a Greek and a Chinese in the same room, probably they're not going to be able to communicate. But if we take the Chinese, we teach him Greek, then they start communicating. Or vice versa, we teach the Greek to speak Chinese and they start communicating. The same thing is, and I'm sure you heard about object-oriented programming and so on. So this is along the same lines. Yeah. And then, of course, because we do have metering and protection throughout the entire electric system, then we can use exactly these devices, simply change their programming to talk the same language. So we use the relays to do protective functions, validate the model, perform parameter identification, and so on. These are all possible with this approach, and then we can transmit the model throughout the chain of all these interconnected computers, and any person that wants to look at this information can look at this information and extract the information or do the particular control functions and operation at that instant of time. So then the way the system is going to look like is as follows. This picture here shows a substation, a very large substation, and you can see distributed here meters that take the measurements and then they transmit the measurements through optical lines into what we call a process bus. Okay? And then we just connect the computers, the various devices so in the process bus, and of course these fiber optic lines have dual communications. They can transmit any commands back to the field. For example, if this is a breaker, can transmit a command to trip the breaker, change the tap of a transformer, and so on. So there is two-way communications that they do both data acquisition and control. Now, this technology exists today. So what we try to do is basically to integrate this technology into a unified system. And the way to unify this system is basically to streamline and have some new approaches of how this whole process can be done. So I'm going to talk to you about one of these processes that is referred to as settingless protection. Basically, in addition to the integration, we get some additional benefits and we can enable protection that is much simpler and much more robust and reliable from the traditional approaches. So settingless protection is basically the process of integrating all the data acquisition and modeling and so on in one box, and comes from the fact that if we look at the various protection approaches we have, the best, the most secure protection approach we have is what we call differential protection, where basically the differential protection is a very simple scheme where it looks at a particular device and looks at the terminal volt currents of this device, and we know that we need to obey Kirchhoff's current law, which means that the sum of the currency has to be equal to zero. So all that the protection scheme does is monitors the sum of the cards going into the device, and if the sum is non-zero, then it interprets this as something being wrong in the device and interrupts, disconnects the device from the rest of the system. Yep. So the question is why we do not take this approach to another level, where basically we look at all the measurements, electrical voltages and so on, temperature, speed, whatever is appropriate for this device, and then monitor basically the equations that all of these variables have to obey. This is what we call the model of the system. The relationship of the various variables of the system is the model of the system, so we monitor basically the model of the system. Of course, this can be done in a mathematical strict way through what we call a dynamic state estimation. So this means that the analytics become a little bit more complex, but the result is the same. We can determine whether the device is operating in normal conditions. So this works as follows, basically. We have the device, we have the meters. Merging units is the new name we use for data acquisition systems with this kind of capabilities. We have the process bus here, and the relay now is nothing else but looks at the model of the device that is monitored. It does a dynamic state estimation and takes decision whether the device should be tripped or not. So it's a very simple process, and of course it looks something like this if we look at the actual data. This particular data is from the protection of a transmission line that has a, what we call a high impedance fault. The high impedance fault generates small changes in the voltages and currents. And through the dynamic state estimation, we can tell that these waveforms of the voltages and currents do not fit with the model of the system during this period, during the high impedance fault. And the relay says that at this point, there is an internal fault in the system and something has to be done to disconnect this line. So it's a very relatively simple approach conceptually. Of course, the analytics are a little bit more complicated than what we do usually for protection of systems. And all of this can be tested in the laboratory. This is a picture of my laboratory at Georgia Tech, where you can see the merging units, the relays, and so on. We use a simulator to simulate the physical system, and then the results of the simulator go through amplifiers, which are shown here, to the merging units. And from this point on, we have the actual physical system of the relay that is tested and so on. And this kind of laboratory is not really that expensive to set up and develop these techniques further and so on. And from the instrumentation point of view, it looks as follows. We have here the simulator through a computer that goes through a digital to analog conversion through the amplifiers. And from this point on, we have the entire system as it is actually in the field through the merging units. In this particular case, the relay is just another computer that does the processing and so on. Now, there are certain many advantages here. First of all, the protection now looks a little bit more to the point where one can visualize what a particular device is doing. For example, here is the, I don't have time to go through the whole organization of the sentinel-less protection, but the result is that we can visualize in real time what's going on. Here is the protection for a transformer. You'll see here there are six circles representing that are used to plot the phasors of the voltages and currents at these terminals of the device. As long as the voltages and the currents are within the rated values of the transformer, they're shown in white. When something goes on, in this particular case, we have a fault outside the transformer. You see the currents increase, the voltages are depressed, and so on. So one can see, can visualize what the actual device is doing and what the actual relay is doing in this case. So it's a new way of looking at the protection of the various devices. Now, what is important here, this is a very busy slide that shows basically the organization of the system with the amplifiers, the merging units, and so on, and how the software is organized. One very important issue here is the following. We have what we call instrumentation verification. That can be done with the through the same state estimation. We can determine if the instrumentation, the data coming into the relays and so on, are verified. And it is a very new important capability, because many times we have issues with the system. For example, if a fuse is blown, then the data is gonna that is going to go into the protection system is going to be altered. We have wrong CT ratios. Somebody made an error, either the new, the wrong current transformer ratio and so on. All of these are what we call hidden failures, because the traditional protection cannot recognize these errors. But with the new systems, we can do a state estimation over the entire system and can identify which part of the instrumentation is wrong, and we can identify the hidden failures. So we have all these advantages. So in addition to the integration, we have all these advantages. We eliminate protection gaps. This is another issue that we can spend a lot of time talking, because basically we have a lot of faults in the system that cannot be recognized with the traditional protection that we have today. And typically this leads to many times electrocutions and so on. And with this technique, with this new technology, we can detect these issues. We can detect hidden failures, reduce possibilities of human error. And another very important issue that we worry about today is physical, cyber physical security. As a matter of fact, we spend a lot of time to include cyber security issues into these systems. And the idea is very simple. Basically, if we have an integrated system, then anytime a command is transmitted, let's say from the control center to the field or from a relay to the field, we can capture this command, analyze, authenticate it, because we know the state of the system, and then we can process this information to see if that command will cause a problem in the system. And then we allow the command to be transferred. And basically, this whole process, the basic idea is to use the lower level, the computers that are either in the relay or the merging unit and so on, that will continuously monitor and validate the model of the part of the system they monitor. And of course, this model can be transmitted throughout to the entire system and utilized for all the issues of protection and control of the system. Now, a lot of these things are still in the development issues. So, for example, we have a demonstration project on the New York, this stands for New York Power Authority. It is a 765-345 kV system. This is the largest, the highest kV level in the United States presently. And the demonstration consists of this system installed on a 765, 345 kV, 13-point kV autobank. This is a huge transformer. Here are the merging units connected to the various parts of the transformer, and a particular a PC acts as the as the protective device there, and also provides the information that collects to the system. Now, one thing that I have not mentioned, in order to achieve all of this, all the measurements have to be synchronized. And today we're using technology, GPS synchronization, to make sure that all the measurements that are taken in a particular device or anywhere in the system are all taken at the same instant of time. The GPS system, I'm sure you're familiar with it, provides the capability to take measurements synchronized with accuracy better than 1 microsecond. Another application is there is a 765 kV line that is, again, in the state of New York. It goes from very close to Montreal all the way to near the New York City. And we have a demonstration there. This is the installation on one end of the transmission line. So all of the systems have to be developed, tested, and so in the field, in addition to the laboratory. And then, of course, all of this information can be done to can be taken and transmitted throughout the system. Here, I'm going to show you briefly how this information can be taken and transmitted and construct the entire system in a control center. I'm going to skip some of the details. Basically, at every substation, taking the information from these devices, we can transmit them into the control center, where at the control center, we can synthesize the entire system. Here is where the GPS synchronization comes becomes very important, because basically I can compute the state estimate of the of every substation at the same instant of time, and then when I transmit this information to the control center, I can merge the state of the same instant of time of the various substations to obtain the entire picture for the entire power system. And then, based on that, I can do all the optimization and control of the system. So, self-managing operations planning is done the same way. Now, we have a platform that distributed the entire system exists at any instant of time. And then I can do an optimization. And, of course, because of the distributed nature of the problem, I can optimize a feeder. Then the feeder, the result of the optimization of the feeder is an aggregate model of this feeder that is applied to the substation optimizer. The substation optimizer optimizes all the feeders based on the aggregate models, and then the aggregate model of the substation is fed to the entire system, where the entire system is optimized. So this is a distributed hierarchical process, and a lot of things have to be resolved in there. And basically, from an artistic point of view, it looks as follows. Today we have a lot of these things distributed into the system. However, the way today things are, the distributed processors that are throughout the system, think in terms of an electromechanical system of protection and control and operation. Basically, they mimic the operation of the legacy systems of the past. However, we need to work on new technology that will take the same microprocessors, add additional intelligence of the system, and look at the devices from a different point of view. As a doctor looks at a patient, monitors what is going on in the system, and takes decisions based on the condition of this device. Yeah. And from the other point of view, the data acquisition and control, it may look something like this, where near the devices, we try to control the data acquisition are collected, and through fiber optics, we can send back information to the system. So we have in the control house of a substation, for example, can be only one super controller for the entire substation, and so on. So this is the kind of technology that we're moving towards. And I have a challenge to you. Since our forefathers have developed some things that everybody admires today and so on, they have the capability. We and the modern Greeks, we should have the same capability and provide the leadership in all of these new developments. And with this, I guess I will finish this point. And do we have time for any questions? Or?
Ευχαριστούμε πολύ τον κύριο Μελιόπουλο. Θα παραδώσω τώρα το βήμα στον κύριο Χάρη Δημουλιά για να συντονίσει τις ερωτήσεις.
Μπορείτε να κάνετε τις ερωτήσεις στα ελληνικά. Θα προσπαθήσουμε να γυρίσουμε πίσω στα ελληνικά.
Παρακαλώ, ερωτήσεις.
Υπάρχει μία εκεί.
Ναι.
Καταρχήν, Γρηγόρης Παπαγιάννης, είμαι καθηγητής στο Τμήμα των Ηλεκτρολόγων, Μηχανικών και Μηχανικών Υπολογιστών στο τομέα της ηλεκτρικής ενέργειας. Να συγχαρώ τον κύριο Μελιόπουλο για την εξαιρετική του παρουσίαση που μας έδωσε μια εικόνα των σύνθετων καταστάσεων αλλά και των τόσο προκλητικών που μας περιμένουν στο μέλλον. Θα ήθελα να ρωτήσω δύο πράγματα. Το ένα είναι κάπως γενικό και νομίζω ότι ενδιαφέρει περισσότερο και το κοινό, γιατί στις επικοινωνίες με τους φοιτητές διακρίνουμε μια εξαιρετική ευαισθησία απέναντι στην πράσινη ενέργεια, στις ανανεώσιμες πηγές ενέργειας. Και αυτό φάνηκε καθαρά και από την εισαγωγή της παρουσίασής σας. Βιώνουμε όμως μια κατάσταση όπου μετά από εκείνο το έφορο κλίμα το οποίο ξεκίνησε στην Ευρώπη με τους στόχους του 20-20-20 για το 2020 που έγινε μετά 50% για το 2050 και το τέλος πιθανά να ήταν η άκρη του ουρανού, αρχίζει πια να υπάρχει ένας σκεπτικισμός σε σχέση με την εισρωή ανανεώσιμων πηγών ενέργειας στα δίκτυα και σε σχέση με την ικανότητα των δικτύων πλέον να μπορούν να αντεπεξέλθουν στην μεγάλη διείσδυση ανανεώσιμης πηγής ενέργειας. Ήδη αυτή τη στιγμή αντιμετωπίζουμε καταστάσεις όπως έχουμε αρνητικές οριακές τιμές συστήματος στη διάρκεια της ημέρας σε πολλές χώρες της Ευρώπης και γενικότερα υπάρχει μια αίσθηση ότι το δίκτυο πιθανά να τεθεί σε μεγάλο ρίσκο όσον αφορά την αυξημένη διείσδυση ανανεώσιμων πηγών ενέργειας. Θα ήθελα ένα σχόλιο δικό σας πάνω σε αυτό. Η δεύτερη ερώτησή μου έχει να κάνει περισσότερο με τα δίκτυα διανομής τα οποία μοιάζουν να είναι εκείνα τα οποία πιέζονται περισσότερο με τη διανεμημένη παραγωγή. Αυτή τη στιγμή γίνεται μια συζήτηση σε παγκόσμιο επίπεδο σε σχέση με την δυνατότητα των αυτοπαραγωγών, των διανεμημένων παραγωγών στα δίκτυα διανομής να παρέχουν βοηθητικές υπηρεσίες στο δίκτυο, ancillary services. Και μια συζήτηση κατά πόσον οι διαχειριστές των δικτύων, οι DSOs, θα μπορούν να κοστολογήσουν κατάλληλα αυτές τις υπηρεσίες. Θα ήθελα επίσης αν έχετε κάποιο σχόλιο πάνω σε αυτό. Ευχαριστώ.
Ευχαριστώ για την ερώτησή σας. Και οι δύο ερωτήσεις είναι πάρα πολύ to the point, διότι στην αρχή είχαμε μεγάλη οι πράσινες ενέργειες ήταν η απάντηση που είχαμε στο ενεργειακό πρόβλημα. Δυστυχώς όμως, μερικά από τα προβλήματα που συζήτησα στην παρουσίασή μου είναι ότι δεν είναι reliable and we cannot depend on them. So if we have to depend on thermal units to make up for the uncertainty in these devices, then we need to devise new ways to dealing with that. For example, if we look at what happened in Spain, where Spain went very high on wind energy, then finally they realized all of these problems and then they curved it. The reservometer that I mentioned to you is basically one of the issues to resolve these problems. That is, we have to use now the customers subsidizing for the uncertainty of the wind power. The same thing for the photovoltaics. Think about the following thing. Next year, we're going to have a major sun eclipse in the Europe. So if we're dependent on photovoltaics only, that day will be a dark day, literally dark day. Yeah? So that's why the integration that I mentioned, we need to work on this so we can make the renewables the solution to the energy grid. All of this activity that I mentioned is striving basically for this problem. At Georgia Tech, we're working with the 2030 planning case for the Midwest of the United States. Initially, the plan was to install something like 100 gigawatts of wind energy plus 30 gigawatts of photovoltaics in that region. That will make it about 60% renewables. But all the planning studies and the problems we facing for that region, they start curbing these plants. And now the plants look a lot more moderate than it used along the lines that what Professor Nikos mentioned. Okay? And the two questions are interrelated because as we have more and more customers with the resources that are capable of providing ancillary services, controlling voltage, providing energy to the grid when the grid needs it, and of course, depending on the grid when the renewables on the house or on a distribution system are not there, the grid has to provide this. The same technology can solve this problem. That is, we have to have a distributed technology that is integrated and addresses the whole issue together. So the two problems are interrelated. Thank you for the question.
Άλλη ερώτηση. Κύριος Ανδρέου.
Καλημέρα. Λέγομαι Γιώργος Ανδρέου, είμαι λέκτορας στο τμήμα ηλεκτρολόγων μηχανικών του Αριστοτελείου. Και ήθελα να σας ρωτήσω κάτι το οποίο υπάρχει πάρα πολύ σαν ερώτηση τα τελευταία χρόνια στην Ευρώπη και κυρίως στην Ελλάδα. Η στροφή στις ανανεώσιμες πηγές κατά κύριο λόγο σήμαινε μια πολύ μεγάλη εισρωή ιδιωτικών κεφαλαίων στα συστήματα ηλεκτρικής ενέργειας, αλλά ως προς την παραγωγή. Ξαφνικά ανακαλύψαμε ότι υπάρχουν μια σειρά από μεγάλα προβλήματα στη μεταφορά και τη διανομή και όπως μας δείξατε, υπάρχουν πολύ ωραίοι τρόποι για να λύσουμε αυτά τα προβλήματα, αλλά πάντα υπάρχει εξής ερώτηση. Τι θα γίνει με το κόστος? Δηλαδή, ποιος θα πληρώσει όλη αυτή την καινούργια τεχνολογία? Και φυσικά αυτός που θα την πληρώσει θα θέλει να έχει και μια, να πάρει και τα λεφτά του πίσω. Οπότε θα ήθελα παρακαλώ ένα σχόλιο πάνω σε αυτό. Ευχαριστώ.
Ακριβώς. Ευχαριστώ και για την ερώτηση. This question goes to the heart of the problem because basically the green power, the renewable sources today are the cost is higher than the conventional legacy sources. Yeah. And the cost vary, of course. Wind power is relatively lower cost and is financially viable and so on. Photovoltaics is a bit higher cost and so on. The integration, on the other hand, we know the following thing, that the value of the green power is if we are able to integrate everything together. For example, there are certain secondary issues that affect the cost. For example, if we can make photovoltaic plants, wind plants, to provide ancillary services and help the security and the reliability of the system, that's worth an additional amount of money which can be counted against the initial cost. So integration is the answer to bringing the cost down. On the other hand, of course, we know that the costs are coming down, but at the same time, there is a humongous amount of investment that has to be done, not only the actual resources, but also planning accordingly the transmission and distribution system. So again, the integration technologies, they strive to minimize the overall cost, not only the initial installation cost, but also the cost of operation and so on. In my mind, it may happen that at some point in time, these costs together in an integrated system will come down to be comparable with the traditional legacy generation, but there is a long way to go. Certain technologies have to be developed before we get to that point. Yes. Thank you.
Επόμενη ερώτηση, ο κύριος.
Καλημέρα, Κωνσταντίνος Γιφθάκης, υποψήφιος διδάκτορας από την Πάτρα είμαι. Χαίρομαι που στην παρουσίασή σας βάλατε σε ένα σημείο το κομμάτι του reliability και του safety στα συστήματα αυτά. Ήθελα να κάνω μία ερώτηση σε ένα συγκεκριμένο κομμάτι. Επισκέφτηκα πέρυσι την EDF στο Παρίσι και εκεί ψάχνανε πάνω στο δίκτυο, ήταν πάρα πολύ σημαντικό για αυτούς, να μπορούν να προβλέψουν με όσο το δυνατόν μεγαλύτερη ακρίβεια ένα σφάλμα πάνω στο δίκτυο και είχαν καταφέρει μετά από μελέτες και μελέτες στο ερευνητικό του τμήμα να προσεγγίζουν σε 5 χιλιόμετρα ακτίνα που έχει γίνει ένα συγκεκριμένο σφάλμα. Όταν αλλάζει η φιλοσοφία του δικτύου και πηγαίνει στο smart grid που έχει πάρα πολλά components, ναι μεν ξέρεις ότι η βλάβη έχει προέλθει από το smart grid 1 και όχι στο δεύτερο, στο τρίτο, στο τέταρτο, αλλά πόσο εύκολο είναι να προβλέψεις ακριβώς τη φύση του σφάλματος μέσα στο δίκτυο αυτό, το location. Αυτό ήθελα να ρωτήσω.
Ευχαριστώ για την ερώτησή σας. Υπάρχει καινούργια τεχνολογία, based on exactly what I presented here. We refer to this, this technology basically provides synchronized measurements at various points of the system. So if, for example, we consider one transmission line and we have the synchronized measurements at the both ends of the line, this approach allows us to pinpoint the fault with much more precision than 5 kilometers. Basically, within the tower, we can tell where the fault is. So integration and synchronization provides new ways of pinpointing the fault. I'm going to take your question one step further, because basically we have situations now where when there is a fault in the system, if we have on one side the traditional system with the traditional synchronous machines, and on the other side we have renewables, as will happen, for example, on a line along feeding a wind farm and so on, then we have the situation where when a fault is happening, then we have a very high contribution from the traditional system and very little contribution from the wind farm, because the power electronics limit the fault currents. So we have the situation where we try to pinpoint the fault location, where on one side we get very high fault currents and very small currents on the other side. But this technology that I mentioned, the integrated technology with synchronized measurements, has the capability to pinpoint the fault, even in this case, very accurately. So there is a lot of papers, and I will be glad to point you to this kind of presentations, publications with this new technology. Thank you.
Έχουμε χρόνο για μία τελευταία ερώτηση, παρακαλώ.
Καλημέρα και ευχαριστούμε για την παρουσίασή σας. Εγώ θέλω να κάνω μια τεχνική ερώτηση. Σε περίπτωση που χάσει το συγχρονισμό το GPS, κάποιος αισθητήρας χάσει το συγχρονισμό του, ή διαφορετικά κάποιος κακόβουλος χρήσης το παρεμβάλλει, τι θα γίνει σε αυτή την περίπτωση? Και επίσης ένα σχόλιο θα ήθελα πάνω σε big data των smart grids, γιατί βλέπω παίζουν πολύ τελευταία. Ευχαριστώ.
Δεν κατάλαβα τη δεύτερη ερώτηση.
Βλέπω ότι το trend τώρα στα smart grids είναι τα δεδομένα, επειδή είναι πάρα πολλά, αναφέρεται σαν big data. Πάνω εκεί γίνεται η επεξεργασία, έτσι ώστε να μπορούμε να προβλέψουμε διάφορα σφάλματα στο δίκτυο και διάφορα άλλα. Θα ήθελα ένα σχόλιο πάνω σε αυτά, πού εφαρμόζονται, τι γίνεται πάνω σε αυτά.
Ωραία, ευχαριστώ. Ευχαριστώ για την ερώτηση. The first question has to do with the reliability of the GPS system. Since all of these technologies now rely on the GPS system, because we cannot achieve the things that I talked to you without GPS synchronization, then the question is, if we lose the signal, what happens? Well, we have very good news here. Basically, people have developed backup systems that are totally inexpensive, that we can place at every point in the system. For example, the projected today we can go get these systems with a few hundred dollars, but the projection of these systems is going to be something like $30, where we can put them next to the monitoring systems and so on, and they can hold the GPS signal for something like 10 minutes a day, depending on what technology we use, so we can have full reliability of the GPS signal. So the answer to this, technically, if you would ask me this question about 3 years ago, I would tell you, yes, this is a very big problem. Today is not a big problem. And that indicates basically how dynamic this technology is. Things are happening every day. Now, the other question regarding the big data and the smart grid and so on, I would like to refer you back to the slide ahead with the sophistis, I guess. A lot of approaches have to do with big data, and we have a lot of computer scientists. No offense to the computer scientists, but really we need to get the computer scientists to talk the electric power energy system language as well. So they need to start analyzing the data, not only as data with no relationship to the physical system from where they're coming from, but basically analyzing the data with respect to the physical system they're coming from. So when we do that, then we have to have a process such as state estimation, dynamic state estimation, and so on, where basically we relate this data to the physical system. When we do that, this big data become small data for the following reason. Think about the following process. Today, in a substation that has smart grid technologies, we collect data at the rate of several million pieces of data per second. Now, if you ask the information, the question, how much information exists in these several millions of data points, the answer will be very small. With 30, 50 pieces of data, I know what's going on in the substation. So we really need to look at this data from this point of view, that to extract the information, and we can do that only if we relay this data back to the physical system from which it comes from. And then we're dealing with very small data. As a matter of fact, your question relates also to another big problem we have with the smart grid. That is, if we simply take data and we transmit the data through communication circuits, then we do not have the bandwidth in the communication circuits to transmit this data. So with the technologies that we're describing, we can reduce the data only to information, and then the communication circuits we have now, they're capable of, they have the bandwidth to transmit this data to any location with minimum latencies and so on. So this is one of the biggest problems with the smart grid, and we really need to take the big data, reduce it to information, and then deal with information. That's, but again, we are not there doing that yet, but we need to be working towards this goal. Thank you.
Ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ.
Thank you again for the invitation. It has been a pleasure to be here in στην όμορφη Θεσσαλονίκη.
Ακολουθεί coffee break κάτω στο foyer. Σε ένα τέταρτο επιστρέφουμε με τα session της ενέργειας.